row is still wide open here. That's what they say in churches, is the ball head row? It's the front row?
I got hair.
You got hair. You don't qualify.
Oh. Ouch, 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 ouch.
Just come in and have a seat, if you will, please.
David, don't be angry at your bedside. I know.
For those of you who don't know, my name is Trilby Leach, and I was one of the founders of the Concerned Citizens of Forsyth County Tea Party many years ago. And then we joined with another group and became the Forsyth County Tea Party Patriot Alliance. And a few months ago, we did it again. We joined another group, and now we're the United Tea Party of Georgia. And everyone said, who is this guy who always stands up there and leads the meetings? Well, I'm going to introduce you to him. And where is Steve? Come on up this way. What we have done is by joining the parties together and becoming one party, you now have an opportunity to go to three different meetings, one in Lawrenceville, one in Suwanee, and this one. So we're all the same group, United Tea Party of Georgia. Steve Ramey is from Lawrenceville, and he is one of the co-leaders. And David Hancock, you might remember him, he ran against Rabudol a couple of years ago. And David is in charge of the Suwanee Tea Party, and he also, the two of them, are in charge of this one. So I haven't given up the Tea Party, I'm just moving along a little. So anyhow, I'd like you all to meet these guys. They're very knowledgeable, a delight to know, and I hope that you will give them a warm welcome. But before we do that, I'm getting the old eagle eye here from Pastor Bean. And so he's going to lead us in prayer and the pledge.
May we stand. Father, we have a country that was founded by you and people that were believing in you in how to set forth a country that had never been seen before in the existence of the world. And now, Lord, we are the representatives of that same group down through the ages. And we pray today, Lord, as the Tea Party and the government of our country wakes up and serves you and then brings our country back to the Constitution and the Declaration of Independence. We do pray for that. And we pray, Lord, that you will be pleased with this group and those who conduct the meeting and he who is going to speak. Tonight, Lord, we bring you these things in the precious name of Jesus, the risen Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Everybody hear me? Okay. About 6 years ago, I decided that we needed a more conservative group in Gwinnett County. And so I got together with eight people in my den, and now I think we have a list of around 3,000 people on our email list. So we have grown sizably since then. It has been a journey that I've loved the whole way and had so much fun and met so many great people out of it. About a year and a half ago, you got involved?
2 years ago.
2 years ago? Time flies. Anyway, I needed some brains to come along with this thing. So I happened to think of David. David's one of the smartest guys I know, one of the most honest guys I know. So I invited him to come and participate with us, and he's added a new dimension that I could never bring to it. So I want you to welcome him in here and his brain to go along with it. And anyway, we would like to welcome all of you to our group. It is getting larger, it's getting better, and it's getting more powerful. And the bigger we are, folks, the more power we have. So we got to remember, and we've got Mr. Olens back here. There he is. Mr. Olens, of course, is Attorney General for the state. And we got to remember that the states created the federal government, not the other way around. So we get the opportunity to have an Attorney General who can bring us those rights back, okay? So here's David.
Thank you. We'll get started. We have constitutions available. If anybody needs a pocket constitution, there's some back there. I've got some here. We have flag pens also. And I've got a giveaway tonight, the real George Washington. I don't know if you've read any of these. There's the real Thomas Jefferson, the real George Washington. This is an excellent book. I have some raffle tickets, but I could not find them. So one of the things we do sometimes is we ask, not trivia questions because it's our country, but we ask questions that help weed people out. So what about, who knows the plural, if you have the Attorney General from five states in one place, what's the plural for that? No, you don't count, Jack. Yes, ma'am.
Attorney General.
Very good. Would you like this book? Okay. You will read it? It's almost daunting, but thank you. Flag pens and other stuff. I do want to thank all of you, especially those of you who come to multiple meetings. So we see some of you at three of our meetings, and I don't know how you put up with us for that long, but we really do appreciate it. Bill Corkley has something he would like to say. Where is he? Oh, there he is, right there.
That's a good name. Thanks. My name is Bill Coakley. I serve Congressman Doug Collins. When I got in the car headed up here, I called a friend of mine. I call him on a fairly regular basis. I want you all to keep a family in prayer tonight. Most of you know who Roger Fitzpatrick is. Roger Fitzpatrick is a dear friend of mine. Roger lost his brother today in a bicycle accident. He was hit in Braselton. And I want you all to just take a few moments and remember Roger and Linda. I cannot remember Roger's parents. I just call them Mom and Dad. And if you would, please join me in a short prayer. Our gracious Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day. We ask your blessings upon the Fitzpatrick family in this very, very tough time for them. We can be assured, knowing David, that he heard the words that all followers of Christ desire to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter now into the joy of your Lord. Amen. Thank you.
I'd like to go ahead and get started then. We have Attorney General for the state of Georgia, one of our constitutional officers, has agreed graciously to come. And I saw a teaser for a presentation he gave a while ago, and I thought, I wish I could have made it. And so I decided, well, let's try to get him here. I'm excited about it. Somebody was mentioning back to the Constitution and Declaration of Independence. I was reading a book. Mike Lee has a new book he's got out. And in the introduction to it, he talks about an exhibit he's got in his office. He says he has two stacks of papers. And one of them is a stack of all the legislation that was passed in 2014. He says it's about 3 inches tall, and it's 800 pages. And that's a bit, but still. The next stack to it is 11 feet tall. It's 80,000 pages, and it's all the regulations that were passed by EPA, OSHA, all the other agencies. So Congress is delegating their responsibility. They create an agency, and it gets out of hand. Our state is something that there's some issues that are coming up, as we all know, that are vital, and we have some good people in the state of Georgia, and so without further ado, Attorney General Sam Olens.
Do y'all need the microphone? Do y'all need the microphone?
No.
Yes.
Can we have a vote? No. Okay, so I'm Sam. It's a pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure to see Bill here from Congressman Collins. I get to work with the congressman at times on different issues. We'll touch one issue where Bill's boss, Congressman Collins, and I have been working together on. And it's a pleasure. I know Steve from way back. I didn't know he knew how to get to Forsyth County from Gwinnett County. So we'll see. And Ethan, I've known for years as he's been active in the local Republican Party. These characters from up north showed up, and from Cherokee, a little bit of everything around here at that point. Of course, Nydia and I have been involved in numerous incidents, shall we say, over the process as she tries to uphold her First Amendment constitutional rights. So first of all, so I'm the state's lawyer. So that means that I represent the state of Georgia, I represent the governor and all the executive agencies. And it's a great, great job. It's a fun job. Great issue. Some of it's just day-to-day representation. Some of it is looking in the newspaper going, the employee for the state really thought that was a good idea. Or some of it is, that's the newest lawsuit. So the two folks that generally get sued the most in the state are the governor and me. Often together, often neither of us are the right defendant, but that doesn't stop people, it's just easier. A lot of times I get sued simply because I'm supposed to enforce the laws, so if they don't like the laws, they want to sue me so that I won't potentially enforce the laws. A lot of times we're just sued because. And one of the things, you know, I know Ethan's a lawyer, there's probably maybe some other lawyers in the room. One of the things that always cracks me up is, you know, when you're a lawyer, you're always taught that if, you know, your client has been sued and he's not the right party, you immediately make a motion to dismiss, or and you sit there and say not the real party in interest, that someone else should be sued. But we don't do that, because if I make a motion that I'm not the real party in interest, it's someone I represent. So from the office's perspective, I'm just giving them work. Because if they have to file the motion to change the name of the defendant and they're still representing the defendant, they have no gain. So they're perfectly happy for me to be the defendant in all these cases. I'm not so happy about it, but they're fine with it at that point. So it's fun day to day when any of the colleges, the technical colleges, we represent all of them, all the boards and authorities, some that shouldn't exist, some that should exist, anything and everything. And once in a while, I've got a little sheet in my office of all the authorities and who the lawyers in our office are primary in that representation. And every once in a while, I'll find that there's an authority that we don't have down on our list, because there's that many authorities and boards. So you sort of call up and say, well, who's heard of this one before, and who should we have represent them? So it gets a little interesting. We have too many, shall we say. So I'm here to talk about federalism, so I'll give a quick 2-minute intro for the two younger folks in the room about the Constitution, and then we'll go from there. So first of all, Patrick Henry stated, the Constitution is not an instrument for the government to restrain the people. It is an instrument for the people to restrain the government, lest it come to dominate our lives and interests. And when you look at it, that's something very, very special about our Constitution, because most constitutions restrain the people. Most constitutions give rights to the government. Our Constitution's very different. It restricts the government and gives rights to her people. Now, many of us may take that for granted, but if you actually take the time to look at other national constitutions, it's very, very different. So how does our Constitution do that? I'm glad you asked. So first of all, our Constitution has enumerated powers. And we talk a lot about the fact that you're supposed to look in the Constitution, where does it say an issue's federal, where does it say it's the role of the federal government, and where it's not, then by definition, it rests elsewhere with the state and her people. It has enumerated freedoms, and some of you may say, well, what are the enumerated freedoms? It's called the Bill of Rights. So the Bill of Rights, very, very different than a normal constitution, provides enumerations. And I know a lot of times people want to choose which one's more important than the other. Some people say the first, some people say the second, some people will say fourth, fifth, sixth, etc. I'm not there to have a fight over which one's more important. They're all in our Constitution. We spend a lot of time on the First Amendment. We spend a lot of time nationally on the Second Amendment. Georgia doesn't have as many issues, for instance, as if you live in the Ninth Circuit, or if you live in the city of Chicago, you live in the District of Columbia. So we frankly have less of that litigation than is found elsewhere in the country. And you've got structure. So what do I mean by structure? Well, you've got the first four articles of the Constitution. So Article 1 is the legislature, Article 2 is the president, Article 3 is the courts, Article 4 provides other grounds. We deal a little bit with Article 6, which is the supremacy clause that comes into being, and then the 10th Amendment. The 10th Amendment, of course, added an amendment that sought to clarify any discussion left from the Federalist Papers with regard to that issue of federalism. So we spent a lot of time in that regard. And then when we were celebrating the anniversary of the Constitution recently, we had Justice Scalia in town. And Justice Scalia talked about how different our country was structured with regard to the separation of powers. You know, in many countries, there is a part of government literally more powerful than the others. So, you know, clearly this president thinks it's the executive branch. Many people think it's the legislative branch because that's Article 1 rather than Article 2. Some people, if they don't like the decision of the Supreme Court, they decide it became Article 3. Most people will tell you from the Founding Fathers it really was intended to be Article 1, meaning Congress at that point. So you've got, and then you've got the bicameralism. Most countries don't have both a House and a Senate. Unicameral, and in fact, we have several states, like Nebraska, if I remember correctly, that is unicameral. And then that goes all over the place. Vermont has many, many members of its House. Other state legislatures have very few members. Georgia, of course, 180 in the House, 56 in the Senate. A couple folks in here can tell me they know all of them. I don't think that's a good thing. So the Constitution's intended to secure liberty, unlike most constitutions. So while I do the day-to-day representation for the governor and all the agencies, something that I spend an awful lot of time on is this issue of federalism. Literally, what's the role of the federal government versus the state governments? And we spend a lot of time, a lot of litigation, a lot of multi-state litigation in that area. Now, you may say, well, I hear where three states may be in this suit and Georgia's not in, etc. We all have our ground rules, shall we say. So I'll tell you a couple of my ground rules. Number one, I don't get paid more if I sue the president. So I'm interested in whether I think I can win the suit rather than I can make the front page. So there are certain suits I'm not so crazy about legally, so I don't enter them because I want to win. I have limited resources in my office, and by that I'm predominantly talking people. So I want them to spend their time where we have the best chance to win. Secondly, I tend not to get involved in litigation elsewhere in the country unless it is what we would call a cert petition, a petition for certiorari to the U.S. Supreme Court. So for instance, if you're dealing with the Ninth Circuit, those decisions don't affect us. We live in the 11th Circuit, Alabama, Florida, and Georgia. So even if I disagree with the lower court below, I'm not apt to get involved in the Ninth Circuit case because even if I win, it doesn't change the law here. Mm-hmm. However, if they apply to the U.S. Supreme Court, and if the U.S. Supreme Court takes the case, that then does affect the whole country to include the 11th Circuit. So I generally will not get involved at the circuit level unless it's the 11th, but I will get involved when it's a cert petition to the U.S. Supreme Court or if cert is granted where the U.S. Supreme Court is going to hear it. So every year we probably have amicus briefs, which would be amici, plural, like attorneys general, or we're a party in about 20 cases in front of the U.S. Supreme Court. So I've learned I'm supposed to be near my office the last week of June, because that's when the big cases generally come out. Now, one thing that really bothers me at the moment is, as I put it in here, no American should be willing to sacrifice liberty, our freedom to govern ourselves for the sake of a political agenda. So what I see happening a lot on the left is if they like the president's policy, they don't care about the means, they only care about the end. I think that's really very dangerous, because if you don't care how you get there, you just care about the ends. And if the federal judiciary defends that practice, those same folks that may be so pleased with a directive, guidance, rule, regulation by the president and those agencies may not be so thrilled with those actions of the next president. And I don't think government works best when it goes from one extreme to another. I think government does best when there's consistency, what we would call in the legal profession the rule of law. So we spend a lot of time on the rule of law. Now, having said that, let me also tell you one other thing. If I take a case to the U.S. Supreme Court, or I file a brief, an amicus brief in the U.S. Supreme Court, they are the law of the land. I may disagree with their decision, but we live in this country, and the Supreme Court is the law of the land. So, for instance, when the Supreme Court ruled against my position on the Affordable Care Act, that is the law of this land. That is our Constitution. And I say that knowing some of you may disagree with me, but I don't care. Because Article 2, Article 6, Paragraph 2, the Supremacy Clause, is what counts. We are not governed by anarchy. We're governed based on our Constitution. So, where are we involved? Well, clearly we're very involved in federal overreach. Very involved in federal overreach. Let me give you a couple examples. I already mentioned the ACA case, National Federation of Independent Businesses versus Sebelius. We won where we were supposed to lose, and we lost where we were supposed to win. Putting that in English, that means the administration said it didn't violate the Commerce Clause. We said the individual mandate clearly violated the Commerce Clause. Also necessary and proper. But I don't want to get that legalese. We also said that it was oppressive to require the expansion of Medicaid. And we were told that position was laughable. We were told we should be sanctioned for bringing a frivolous claim. So what happened? Well, we won on the necessary and proper and Commerce Clause issues, but somehow or another, the Chief Justice decided it was a tax and spend issue, even though no one was pleading that. And the President specifically said that it's not legal under the tax clause, that's not our intent. Thankfully, we did win, though, on the expansion of Medicaid claim, where the court specifically held it was oppressive. So that was a big win. In fact, Justice Roberts said, Congress has no authority to order the states to regulate according to its instructions. Now, what we've seen since then, as was referenced earlier by David, is the president rules by regulatory agency. So by definition, we're one of eight states that filed an amicus brief in the King versus Burwell case. Now, if you literally look at the Affordable Care Act, it says you have the subsidies for state exchanges. Now, what happened is 37 states have a federal default exchange, including our state. Some states originally wanted a state exchange, but they found out that the federal government was telling them exactly how it had to be worded. And some of those states said, well, if you're going to tell us how we have to do it, why are we paying to do it? You can do it with your money. Other states like Georgia just said, we don't like the law. We don't want to be part of the law. It's yours. We'll be part of the federal exchange. Now, some people said that was simply a typographical or other administrative error by Congress. Well, it wasn't. Because in the first and second drafts of the bill, it said state or federal. In the final version that passed, it said only state. So it was an overt decision to change the language. And in fact, that famous professor that got paid a heck of a lot of money has admitted it. So Congress, once again, trying to be oppressive, Congress / the administration, the Democrats controlled both houses, specifically did that. So what's really interesting is this. You know, lawyers go by all these fancy Latin phrases. And it's really good when you're playing Scrabble. So there was a case recently in the courts, Yates versus United States, that dealt with Red Grouper. Any of you hear about it? Okay, you need to learn about Red Grouper. So it was a fisherman on the Gulf Coast, and he was catching Red Grouper. And the feds came up and they said, you're catching small Red Grouper. The law says you can only catch big Red Grouper. When you go back, we're going to cite you and charge you. Well, what do you think the fisherman did? As soon as the feds moved away with their boats, he threw the little fish overboard and went to catch more big grouper. But alas, when he came back to shore, they recognized him and they noticed the little fish were no longer in his boat and he now had all these big fish. So they charged him with a violation of Sarbanes-Oxley. And they charged him with a violation of Sarbanes-Oxley. You remember that was post-Enron, Sarbanes-Oxley? And the idea was that the fish were a tangible object. Now we all know that when they were passing Sarbanes-Oxley, they weren't talking about grouper. They were talking about financial instruments. So it was a 5-4 decision. Should have been 9-0, but it was a 5-4 decision. And Justice Kagan wrote the dissent. And Justice Kagan said, you need to look at the exact words. When the words are clear, you follow them. Okay? Now we come to King versus Burwell. It says state exchange. Used to say state or federal. When they're having the oral argument, she goes, well, you really don't look totally at the exact wording. You look at the whole concept. So in other words, the Latin phrase is change. The Latin phrase should change based on how you want to vote. No, and that's not the way the Constitution works. So we will hear the last couple of days of June in King v. Burwell. Now, I mentioned at the beginning part, I get involved in the cases that I think I have a good shot to win, rather than cases that make the front page. Only 8 attorneys general had the guts to do the amicus brief on King versus Burwell, because folks like Jay Bookman were going to say we were hardcore extremists that didn't care about poor people or didn't want people to have insurance. Wrong. George is one of the 8 because we think that the law is clear and it needs to be followed. So it's not a popularity contest, it's when you think you got a good argument to win. And I would suggest only 8 of us had the guts to do that, which is important that that was done. Now, in addition to ACA, we're clearly involved in many, many areas. Georgia is one of 11 states that sued the administration over Dodd-Frank. And that case was recently argued in the DC Circuit case. We're waiting to hear back that opinion any day. DC Circuit is the small Supreme Court. That's where all the appeals go from federal agencies. We're one of the 26 states, we actually were the 2nd state to get involved in the Texas immigration lawsuit, which is where the president, in the name of prosecutorial discretion, wants to add 4 to 5 million undocumented individuals and give them rights that they're not entitled to. Now, once again, that's not an issue of immigration. My family came from Belarusia. I understand that America is greater through legal immigration. I understand that, well, frankly, you know, we all immigrated here in large part. But there's also the rule of law. And prosecutorial discretion is the opposite. That's when you defer to take action, generally because of inadequate resources. This isn't a deferral. This is an addition. You're literally adding 4 to 5 million folks, giving them a Social Security card, giving them a driver's license. It is the opposite of prosecutorial discretion. The federal judge, Judge Hayden in Texas, ruled against the administration. They now have appealed to the 5th Circuit and were actively involved in that case. Now let's talk about 2 more cases. That being with Doug Collins' favorite regulatory agency, perhaps the EPA. So one proposed rule we simply call 111D. Section 111D. So some of you have heard the idea, the president's war on coal. Well, 111D is the president's war on energy. It tells states how much we can have for coal, natural gas, renewable, nuclear, everything. In the Clean Air Act, there's a theory called cooperative federalism, where the EPA tells us where they want us to be for clean air, and you leave it to the states how to get there. But this administration's decided that no, not only do they need to tell us, but they need to tell us how, which we totally disagree with. The other thing that's really harmful for Georgians is Georgia's one of three states that's actively involved in adding new nuclear: Tennessee, the TVA, South Carolina, and Georgia. So if you have utilities in your state that are constantly asked by the public to clean up the air, as our utilities are, so you take an old coal plant, you convert it to natural gas. They did one near me that was about a $3 billion cost, but the people like it because there's a lot less coal cars, so there's less traffic interruption, and the natural gas is cleaner. But if you do it before the EPA tells you to do it, you get zero credit for both the improvement of the air and the cost that we pay as ratepayers. If you wait till they tell you, then you get the big benefit, which is absurd. The EPA, like every federal agent, should want to thank states and utilities that put up those dollars to clean up the air, rather than to wait till the big bad federal government orders that you do so. So it's a disincentive for good behavior. Same thing with nuclear. Because Georgia already had the permitted approval for those plants, ratepayers in Georgia are committed for $14 billion, with a B, dollars. We get zero credit in this energy rule because we did it before they came out with Rule 111D. So when they finalize that rule later this year, I think it's a pretty good bet you'll see Georgia suing, along with many other states in that regard. Another proposed rule is called Waters of the United States. So, bad for farmers, bad for developers. What it says is that if you have land where even as little as one time a year you have standing water, on a case-by-case basis, at a minimum, you need to go to the EPA because you may need a permit. In other words, we have this thing in the state of Georgia, EPD, Environmental Protection Division, one of my clients. No, you shouldn't go to the state agency. You have to go to the federal agency to get your permit. So if you're a farmer and it rains 6 inches, so water is standing from day one to day two, before you can touch that dirt again, you may need a federal permit, NEPA permit. Absurd. There's two U.S. Supreme Court cases that totally, again, go against what they're arguing. So once again, Representative Collins has had a couple hearings, and he's been telling them they're 100% wrong. Everyone who reads the U.S. Supreme Court decisions knows they're wrong. We're waiting to hear back from there. The other area that Representative Collins has been very active in that we appreciate, you can tell him to just send me a birthday cake in a couple months. Okay, there we go. There's a process that we commonly call sue and settle. So what happens is a green group will go up to the EPA and say, you know, we think you need to be doing X, Y, and Z, but you may not have the regulatory authority to do it. So what will happen is they'll have an agreement in advance where they sue the EPA, and the same day that the EPA is sued, they ask the federal court for a consent order. That means the state of Georgia, the industry, the people are not part of the suit. You file the suit and the consent order the same day. And then we're going, what happened? We missed it. No federal agency should be able to settle a case the same day they're sued with the folks suing them, because by definition, that doesn't pass the smell test. Now, having said that, let's cover the other issue before someone hits me with it. Do I think we should do more to clean our air? Absolutely. Do I think we should do more to clean water? Absolutely. But do I think the regulations and policies should be based on hard science with a cost-benefit analysis? Absolutely. So I want clean air, I want clean water, but I want the standards to be based on science and not what makes you feel good at that point, if you follow me. So Congressman Collins has actually been very, very involved in EPA issues, which we appreciate. So that's some of the stuff we're involved in. Clearly, we're involved in more of the litigation that I'm mentioning. And at this time, I'm happy to take any questions that you have. Anyone except that guy Jack from up north of here. Yes, sir.
Baker.
My question is whether I heard you correctly to say that our rights come from the Constitution.
Well, one could sit there and say, go back further and say our rights come from God at that point. But when we're in a courtroom, if you assume those rights from God are put in the Constitution by our founding fathers, the court is looking to what's in the Constitution.
I'm not sure I quite understand that, because there's a certain premise that's established for the authority of the Constitution. And if that doesn't go back to the basic kernel of authority, which, as you just said, is God.
Yeah, I'm not disagreeing with you.
Then that's got to be a legal presumption as well, as if it flows into the Constitution. So if you're not disagreeing with me, then I don't have a disagreement.
No, that's semantics. We're not disagreeing.
Okay, then that being the case, my last question would be, if I understood you correctly, your idea of federalism, mm-hmm. and that the authority of the Supreme Court is that whatever the Supreme Court might ever say, mm-hmm. is the law of the land.
Right.
So there's just no step beyond which the Supreme Court might take that we do not have authority to backstop, that the state does not have the authority to backstop to protect the people.
Well, Congress could always pass a law that limits the effect of the Supreme Court ruling.
That they could declare unconstitutional.
Absolutely. And that happens numerous times. So, I mean, sometimes it's done through a constitutional amendment. Sometimes it's done through an act of Congress. So Congress has the ability, Congress or the President, to pass a law, the President to sign the law, that would have an effect on the case.
So the Supreme Court has absolute authority.
Prior to any change potentially available through Congress.
And we have the marriage question coming up for the
right.
Supreme Court.
Right.
So the Supreme Court came out and said that marriage was between four men, or whatever extreme that you want to take it to. The states would have no authority whatsoever, in your view, to backstop it and protect the people away from...
Well, if we follow your example, which is an extreme example,
but if we
follow your example, the answer is yes.
Okay.
And the answer is yes, based on the structure of the Constitution. Now, having said that, my fear a little bit is, depending on the result that we'll probably see the last part of June, we know that the public doesn't have a strong positive opinion about the president. We know the public doesn't have a strong positive opinion on Congress. I would hope that the Supreme Court would not take an action that would severely affect their credibility as an institution too.
They do it all the time.
Well, but some have a bigger effect than others. So my job is to defend state law. So I've defended the constitutional amendment. I've continued to do that. In fact, Georgia was one of, I think, 8 states that filed an amicus brief in support of state constitutional amendments that was filed in the U.S. Supreme Court. But Article 6, Section 2 would say their decision is the decision. Now, we could have a lot of discussion about whether they'd be making a mistake or whether it'd be right, but that would be the law. There's actually other decisions they can make on that case that would cause even more confusion. Let me give you an example of what I'm referencing. One of the potential options would be that they would not force a state to take that position, but that a state would have to honor marriages from states where it's legal. In many ways, that's actually a more difficult scenario because, so when you file a divorce, you are swearing that you live in that location, in that venue. If a couple goes to Maryland to get married, you're not swearing that you're a resident of Maryland. But if you subsequently move to Georgia, you would have to be swearing that you're a resident of Georgia to get the divorce. If they say marriages from other states are legal here, in many ways that is a much murkier scenario for all of us. Divorce, children, etc. Alimony, much, much trickier. So I think that actually is the worst scenario from a legal perspective. It is one of the scenarios that was in the questions presented to the parties for that argument. Now, you haven't asked me what my opinion is on same-sex marriage. You've just asked me, would we be bound to follow that decision?
Your opinion wouldn't matter.
That's true.
Yeah.
That's 100% true. Yes, sir.
When I read the Constitution, I don't see where it says that the Supreme Court can rule on anything they want to.
Look at Article 6, Paragraph 2.
Article 6, Paragraph 2.
The Supremacy Clause.
Okay. Do you really believe that the Founding Fathers, after fighting a war against tyranny, would have granted the creation they were creating the kind of power you claim the Supremacy Clause?
It's not a function of me claiming. There's a whole bunch of U.S. Supreme Court law over centuries that says what I'm saying.
So we're talking case law, not constitutional law.
Based on Article 6, Paragraph 2. And those case laws, cases, frankly, date back to the 18th century. Marbury v. Madison, etc.
Yeah, where the Supreme Court ruled again, unconstitutionally.
I'm just.
And we're stuck with it.
It's my job to be a lawyer and to give you legal answers. It's not my job to give you the answer that you like. and I'm not being flippant. I'm not being flippant at all.
I don't want you to give me the answer that I like. I want you to give me the answer that the Founding Fathers put in this document, not the Supreme Court change.
My job as the state's lawyer is to give you the legal answer.
And one more question.
Yes, sir.
You said a while ago that a ruling in the 9th circuit
would have no effect on us because we're in the 11th.
Why is that? I don't understand that concept.
Because the process is that you first, if it's a federal case, you go to the district court. If you appeal, you then go to the circuit court. And you can ask, it's a general statement, we're doing generalities, not specifics. You would then ask for your case to be heard in the U.S. Supreme Court. The way the system is created, there are some conflicts between the circuits with regard to law. So in Georgia, if the 9th Circuit says the sky is yellow, and if the 11th Circuit, where we are, says the sky is blue, it's blue here, even though it may be yellow in California. That's just the way it works. But if the U.S. Supreme Court rules whatever color they say it is at that point. So all I was saying was that I don't expend resources on cases that don't affect where we are because I don't have those extra resources.
Is that a form of regionalism?
Yes.
How did that get into our system?
It's the process as to the appellate structure, which once again would have fought, came after the formation of the Constitution based on case law. Yes, sir.
I'm studying where it currently stands, where some states have either proposed or passed that all their electoral votes would go to the candidate based upon a nationwide popular vote. Did you?
Okay, so that's determined by each state. So for instance, Michigan, Pennsylvania, a couple states are debating whether they want it to stay the way it is in their states where it's whichever way the popular vote is, it goes 100% of those electoral votes. Some of those states are reconsidering that position, but once again, under our system of law, that is determined by the individual state.
But no states have passed that as yet.
Well, look, there's a whole bunch of states where it is the popular vote determines 100% of the electoral votes. So for instance, in Pennsylvania, that's the way it is. In Georgia, it's not the way it is. It's based on the popular vote. So each state has the right to do it differently.
What you're talking about is they're upset when a national election, president specifically,
right.
Popular vote goes one way and electoral college goes one way. So there are several states, and I think it's three, I think New York is one, that have passed that they will wait and determine their electoral pledges based on the national popular vote.
Which to me is strange.
They can do that. They can do that.
It's a state decision.
Electoral college is in the Constitution, but it's a way, it's like a loophole, and they found it. And I don't know if a good enough state to go along, but if they get California and New York and several other large states, it could have a big impact on whether it's done.
We can all discuss whether we think it's good or bad. I think it's frankly pretty bad. Yes, sir.
I'm kind of getting the impression that the state of Georgia feels like there's a five-person oligarchy running the country instead of being a republic. Because if the Supreme Court says the sky is green, it's green. It doesn't matter whether it's Congress says it, the president, whether any of the states agree with it, whether any individual. So five people in this country can make all the laws and do anything they want. Is that what the state of Georgia
No, that's what the country believes based on the Constitution, not the state of Georgia.
Do they? I mean, isn't the Constitution based upon limiting the government to certain activities?
Absolutely, but the Constitution's also based on the sanctity of the U.S. Supreme Court's decision.
So we are run by a five-person judiciary.
Well, but nothing. Last, and I'm not being flippant, sir, but there's a lot of proposed constitutional amendments. They don't generally go anywhere, but there's a lot of proposed constitutional amendments.
But they would mean nothing if five justices on the court said.
No, you could do a constitutional amendment that would change anything.
Really?
Yes.
What if the five justices said that didn't mean anything, then it wouldn't mean anything.
But there's a whole history in this country of succeeding constitutional amendments having full authority.
But if the judges don't follow the Constitution, and what is to stop them from doing what they want to do?
You know, candidly, the only way I can answer that question is I don't really see it happening because the country would stand for it.
They already have.
It's a difference. It's a difference. I understand where you're coming from.
Right.
But we are based on our structure of government, and that's the way the government is structured. Now, if people want to change the structure, there's a process to do it. I'm not telling you whether you're right or wrong wanting some change. I'm just telling you what the structure is. Yes, sir?
Yeah. One of my fears about the same-sex marriage
thing,
I don't understand why the federal government's defining that anyway.
I understand.
If they do rule that that should be recognized, would that violate some of our amendment rights that are in that same constitution? Say if my pastor refuses to go against his belief on the Bible, is he committing a crime?
And you know, it's interesting because Alabama is discussing whether to pass a law where the state would not be involved in marriage licenses. And from my perspective, what you're really discussing, if I can word it differently, is the friction between the right to practice one's religion and the law. And from my perspective, I don't see where a pastor should be required to do something that they think violates their religion. You do have judges, you do have notary publics, you do have magistrate judges that could perform marriages under our system. I think it would be grossly inappropriate to tell a pastor that he should be taking a position consistent with his religion.
Yeah, it scares me. I think it's going to open it up.
Well, I certainly hope it doesn't. And candidly, until we read what they write at the end of June, we won't know exactly. But I would certainly take the position, and I would certainly defend any religious leader's position that the practice of their faith would be primary before government could ever tell them what to do in a matter like that. Yes, sir.
Two unrelated questions. Can you tell us where we are on our little dust up with Tennessee as far as the water lakes and
okay.
Where it goes?
God, I was almost getting out of here easily. Okay, so, you know, we had a dust up with South Carolina over Charleston. Okay. The Corps of Engineers just approved the record of decision on the basins that relate to Alabama and Florida predominantly. We're in suit with the state of Florida over the Flint, the basin with the Flint and the Chattahoochee. That's in the U.S. Supreme Court. So I sometimes say that I need safe passage, so I can't be involved in suits or potential suits with every single state around us. But from a more serious vein, the legislature's done what they think is necessary to keep such a claim viable. And once again, I'm dealing with a resources issue, and I'm not making excuses. These things take a lot of resources. When we're in litigation with the state and the U.S. Supreme Court, there isn't a day that there aren't many lawyers working on that case. That is my primary responsibility when it comes to water at the moment, with the other basin where the court issued the record decision today being my second one. Mm-hmm. A matter like Tennessee that isn't as salient or time sensitive has to take a back seat to those other two water cases at that point. And also, if you're going to potentially talk to Tennessee or seek a resolution, you don't want to be having that discussion when you've got a case in the U.S. Supreme Court where someone can maybe think that you're not in a strong position. Mm-hmm. So once the Supreme Court potentially rules on that case, that would be a much better time for my office to consider what is or isn't appropriate with Tennessee at that point.
That's good. I need to go to the horses and not hurt so much.
No problem. I mean, we are literally spending, and let me just say, a lot of money every month on the Florida litigation. Mm-hmm. Let me also say that to the extent anyone wants to ask another question on it, I probably said more than I should have, because the court, the special master, has given us a gag order on what's occurring in that case. So I can say we're spending a lot of resources. I don't want to get more specific in that regard. But it, you know, there's nothing more important than water. I know people will say, so I'm very interested in roads. If we don't have water coming out of the spigot, we don't really need to be talking about the interstates. That's really primary. You know, health and safety is primary. So, you know, our office and the governor spend a lot of time on the water cases, as we should.
One last thing. On the Supreme Court, so many decisions, as has been mentioned before, 5-4, 5-4, 5-4.
Right.
And we all pray for Ruth Ginsburg's continued survival
for more years.
But if by chance she is not on it, and the current ruler, I guess, gets to, they can change everything, it sounds like, for years.
Actually, it would keep it the same vote it is now. Let me give you a different aspect. So elections matter. Okay. How many people in six states chose not to vote because they weren't crazy about the Republican? Okay, so elections matter. When people say, well, he wasn't my first choice, you know, I'm sorry, we don't get our first choice, okay? My wife never says that I get my way, you know? I mean, I'm married at the end of June 30 years because I know how to say yes, ma'am, okay? So how many people didn't vote in the November election in six states that could have made a total difference as to who our president? Now, for those individuals that didn't think Romney was conservative enough for them, anyone that's in this room think that he wasn't conservative compared to President Obama?
Yeah.
Anyone think there'd be a difference in Supreme Court nominees, etc.? Mm-hmm. So I understand your point about 5-4. But what frustrates me is we every 4 years have an ability as citizens of this country to make a difference. And for those millions of people who choose to sit home,
shame.
They made a difference, a negative difference. Yes, Jack.
Two clarifications. There have been a couple of cases. One was the Obamacare Act, and the other was Sheriff Mack.
Was what?
When Sheriff Mack, I can't remember the case, but it's where the Supreme Court ruled that the sheriff does not have to carry out the federal responsibility that's up to the federal government.
Right.
So, because that's encroaching on
right.
his right. Why is it that the supremacy clause has been interpreted to refer to all laws rather than just the enumerated powers? The states are supposed, if we understand the Constitution, the states are supposed to retain all of the power, total power, except the enumerated powers. And the supremacy clause, the way that I understand it, means that the states cannot pass laws that are valid, that are in violation of the 17 enumerated powers. But everything else is ours. And we're sitting here now, federalism is being destroyed, because, and it was also set up in the cases, and I think Robert stated that in the case, that if it was allowed to go through and require the states to set up, that federalism would be destroyed. And we don't understand, we're trying to figure out why you and others keep telling us the supremacy clause refers to all law.
Okay, so for instance, let's talk same sex. So the basis for the Supreme Court to rule on this case would be the Fifth Amendment, which is an enumerated power. Now some people say, but the word marriage isn't in the Constitution. The word marriage isn't in the Constitution. Right. But the Fifth Amendment is. So the theory is that, and once again, we're hypothesizing what the Supreme Court may or may not do. But if the Supreme Court were to rule that the Fifth Amendment requires same-sex marriage, that would give them, in theory, the right to do it, because it's based on the Fifth Amendment. Now, if you ask me, and I'll answer the question slightly differently, have we been asleep at the switch for many years? The answer is yes. How many cases did we potentially come up without an appropriate challenge that there was nowhere in the Constitution where a program or an issue was part of the enumerated powers where it was inappropriate? And I'll tell you, absolutely, Americans were asleep at the switch for a long, long time. But you can only move forward rather than backward in that regard. So, for instance, I'll tell you that the Tea Party movement has a lot of positive energy from my perspective, because the challenge of why is something X versus Y is healthy. But I still am bound by the prior decision until the Supreme Court. Absolutely. Absolutely.
If government did not create marriage, what right does government have to redefine marriage?
And that's the argument that's occurring right now in Alabama. It's the discussion they're having right now. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Mr. Olens. My name is Dallas Hamilton. I'm an active member of the Gwinnett GOP and also the Gwinnett Tea Party, which is now part of this party,
sure.
Party group. I'm also the founder of the Republican National Hispanic Assembly,
sure.
Which we're just now getting going in Georgia. It's an affiliate of the RNC. We're looking at a lot of issues, but we're really interested in the issues surrounding open government. So I've been asked to bring a question to you since they know it's coming here tonight. I'd like to read you a quote from an email sent by your office regarding open records enforcement. It's, quote, if a citizen believes his or her rights have been violated but refuses to bring legal action, they are in no position to complain about any conduct of this office. In fact, the law is clear that the Attorney General's action is completely discretionary. Thus, if you or any citizen believe your rights have been violated, you have an obligation, and at the end of the day, to go to court if you want to enforce your rights. That is the way the law works. That said, I want to make clear that the Attorney General and everyone I know in this office seek for the law to be aggressively enforced, unquote. So in Georgia, if someone steals your child's bicycle, you can call the police. The police will fill out a report, investigate the crime, return the bicycle to you if it's recovered, and arrest the criminal. The district attorney would prosecute if an arrest is made. However, if you believe the open records law had been violated, there is no one to help you. You can investigate the problem yourself, hire an attorney, file a lawsuit, pay attorney fees and court costs that can be several thousands, even tens of thousands of dollars, and probably still not prevail. Mr. Olens, you ran for office on an open government platform and said the new Sunshine Law, and I quote, provides my office the tools needed to properly enforce the law. But you have not fined anyone or filed any lawsuits to enforce Georgia's open records law. Do you really think the current process of having your office tell citizens who have concerns about violations of the open records laws that they should spend tens of thousands of dollars to enforce the law themselves is an effective process for ensuring that citizens have access to public records? And I ask that with all due respect.
Okay, so first of all, let's talk about what the law says, because that may be important in your discussion. The The law specifically says we are a mediator. The law doesn't say we're like the police or the prosecutor in your example. In fact, the law limits our jurisdiction. Now, what we did get passed in the law that was really important in 2012 was, prior to that, I only had criminal jurisdiction, and now I have civil jurisdiction. Now, you may say, what's the big deal there? It's very big. Because if a city or county attorney or other government attorney says, I told the agency that what they were doing was correct, I had to go by a beyond a reasonable doubt standard, where the lawyer for that agency was in fact on trial. That was not going to happen in front of a jury. When the law was changed in 2012, when we proceed, I'm under a civil standard, so it makes for a much easier case. So we do sue governments, and we have sued governments. That part of your question was totally fallacious. In fact, the lady over there filming and the city of Cumming are very familiar with my office suing a government, because I sued the city of Cumming. It's now in the Court of Appeals. I also sued the city of Fort Oglethorpe. Now, what happens, you may say, why haven't you sued most cities, more cities or counties? And that's because most cities and counties, when we send them a lawsuit and say we're going to sue you if you don't follow the law, they immediately follow the law. So I don't get paid based on how many suits I file. But I am important in resolving. I am interested in resolving matters. So I would suggest to you that we resolve a lot of matters in that regard. But the essence of your question is that I should be acting like a police officer when a bike is stolen. That is absolutely inconsistent with the statutory section relating to my office. We are overtly charged to seek to mediate, which is what we do day in and day out. Now, talking about resources, I have three people in my office who do that issue all around the state. They do trainings all around the state, and they do memorandums of understanding all around the state, and when we can't resolve a matter, we in fact will sue. Now, there was one lady who filed the suit on her own in Gwinnett County, and she asked in the press why we weren't helping. We actually called her lawyer and said, send us your file so that we can review the file to see if we should get involved. And we were told by the lawyer he didn't want our assistance. So I have for years now listened to that individual complaining that my office didn't do anything after she hired a lawyer, and when she overtly, and when her lawyer overtly told me that they did not want our participation in that matter. So if you hire a lawyer and the lawyer tells me to stay out, he's got it, I'm going to stay out. That's her lawyer.
Sam?
At that point.
Yes. I'm that person in Gwinnett who filed that lawsuit.
Mm-hmm.
When I filed that lawsuit at the urging of Stephen Ritter.
Right.
I met with Stephen. He urged me to file the lawsuit.
Right.
I did. And at the same time that I filed that lawsuit, Georgia Department of Education asked your office for a legal opinion, because Georgia Department of Audits had audited Gwinnett County Public Schools. And for all of you who are not familiar with what he's talking about, Gwinnett County Public Schools was taking education funds and paying the salaries of chamber executives, and they were hiding it in their budget. You don't have to be a CPA to see it. They were calling it banking fees in their budget. No paperwork. When we filed an open records request, they said that there was no paperwork whatsoever to support that. That turned out to be false. So Georgia Department of Education asked Georgia Department of Audits to audit and determine if those payments were legal. The auditor said that it did not appear to be in compliance with Georgia law. We suggest that you ask the Attorney General for a legal opinion and take appropriate action against Gwinnett County School Board members. Department of Education asked Sam Olens for a legal opinion, and instead of issuing a legal opinion, you gave attorney-client privileged advice to Department of Education that is shielded from the public. So to this day, we don't know if that is legal or not.
Nor do I think your fact pattern is correct, but separate and apart from that, mm-hmm. I do represent the Department of Education, so
right,
when
but
you
not
say...
County Board of Schools.
True. So when you say, I was asked by the Department of Education for an opinion, by definition, what I give them is protected attorney-client privilege. The only way that's changed is when the client agrees for us to provide that information. Short of that, I can't.
Right.
So that's not my decision.
There's an existing attorney general opinion that says schools are not allowed to use education funds to pay chamber memberships. So it's quite surprising.
Well, it doesn't say chamber memberships. Let's talk general.
Right.
In general, you're 100% correct. But once again, when I give advice to a client, I'm not at liberty to publicly disclose that without the client's consent, similar to any other attorney.
Right.
I mean, that's something that I deal with day in and day out. Whether I'd like to or not isn't the issue. I can't, unless the client agrees for me to do that.
Right.
There's a lot of cases where I'd like to,
but
I also want to...
Well, let me ask you then, as a citizen...
Right.
Because you and I talked at the Tea Party long before, the Tea Party of Briscoe in Lawrenceville, long before I filed the lawsuit. Do you think that it is appropriate, is it legal in Georgia, does it violate the Education Purposes Clause of the state constitution for Gwinnett County Public Schools to be using education funds to pay chamber executives' salaries?
And it's hard for me to answer your question, even though I'd like to, because your lawyer, frankly, never agreed to share with me the documentation upon which I could base such an opinion.
You did get that information.
Never received it, ma'am. Never received it. Overtly requested it. Stefan overtly requested that we were told to stay out of his business.
I think she asked you a question in principle, though, that you should be able to answer just in principle.
Well, she already is correctly saying that there's an attorney general opinion that has that issue.
I was asking for that information, and I was agreeing to provide that information.
Well, if I just...
No, but ma'am, in all fairness, when you hire a lawyer, I'm bound to go through your lawyer. You know, that's the rules of ethics. When we call your lawyer...
We'll talk offline because there's a lot I'd like to say to you about this, but I don't want to take up this meeting to do that.
Well, look, when someone hires a lawyer, they change the process with how we can deal with them. When that lawyer tells me he doesn't want our help, I have no more ability to be involved in that matter.
Well, I haven't hired a lawyer. Would you answer her question as if I told it to you? And I would like to know what the answer is.
And Hank, if you provide me the documentation to be able to see everything, then I would.
It's just a question in principle of the law.
Oh, it's a general statement. She's stating something that we've said before in attorney general opinions that limits the use of school monies. I'm not disagreeing with her general statement at all, but I haven't been given the data ever to be able to ask it, to answer a specific question there. And when I asked for it, I was told that I wasn't gonna receive it.
So we just need to get you the data then.
You know, we're going probably 2 years from back at this point, correct?
The Department of Education gave you the data. They were the ones who asked for the opinion.
Well, once again, ma'am, we've covered that issue. What I tell a client, I can't disclose, like any other lawyer. Mm-hmm.
The public cannot know.
Just like it happens with any lawyer.
Well,
my rules of ethics are the same way.
What your lawyer, Stefan Ritter, told me at a meeting with Jennifer Hagemeyer, the lawyer for Georgia Department of Education.
Sure.
Now, Jennifer was the one who asked for the opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And then Jennifer denied that she had done so. She said she didn't do that, but she did. I have it in writing. You have it in writing that she did ask for that opinion.
Well, Jennifer, get another lawyer.
Jennifer told me that she had been told by you that she had no legal authority to take any action against Gwinnett County.
So first of all, I've never talked to Jennifer Hackemeyer, so we're using...
Stefan did. Stefan was in this meeting too, and Stefan said the Attorney General had no legal authority to take any action against Gwinnett County neither did DOE.
Okay, this is a private litigation matter that really should be...
No, the lawsuit's been dismissed.
Okay, but the point of the matter is when you make the allegation, my office offered to see all the documents. We were told no. It's really interesting to criticize my office for not taking action when we weren't given the documents. We asked for the documents.
Actually, there never should have even been a lawsuit, Sam. If the law had been enforced, there would have been no reason for an open records lawsuit.
Can we move on?
Yes. Once again, I have ethics boundaries.
I have one more question.
I think it's a fair statement that every session a bill is filed, but it has not passed.
Yeah,
in it.
So there's a pending bill this session too on that. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I wanted to go back to what Mike was talking about, this gentleman and the gentleman over here. I'm not a lawyer. I never studied case law. I'm sure you have, and I'm sure you've buried yourself in it. But what I have done is looked at history. And I have a quote I want to read to y'all. If I can see it. It says, "The germ of dissolution of our federal government is in the constitution of the federal judiciary." In other words, it's the seeds. It's in the federal judiciary. It says, "An irresponsible body, working like gravity by night and by day, gaining a little today and a little tomorrow." Case law, over time, erodes things. Okay? "And advancing its noiseless step like a thief over the field of jurisdiction until all shall be usurped from the states. And that the government of all be consolidated into one. To this I am opposed, because when all government, domestic and foreign, in little as in great things, shall be drawn to Washington at the center of all power, it will render powerless the checks provided by of one government on another." In other words, the states are a check on the federal. "And will become as venal and oppressive as the government from which we are separated." Thomas Jefferson. That's our history. And what we're seeing today.
That's why the founders did not give the Supreme Court the authority.
It's baloney.
Which says they have.
It's utter baloney, in my opinion. I'm yes. not a constitutional authority like our president is.
Oh boy, let's not even go there. Yes.
You've been around us long enough now. You know how most of us in the Tea Party are extremely concerned about where we're headed as a nation.
Sure.
We believe that our Constitution is being shredded because lawyers are misinterpreting what the founding fathers truly meant to establish by having a federalist system.
That's right.
What hope do we really have if our attorneys general, our governors, our legislature, what hope do we have to maintain this republic, to pass on to our children, if all power is going to remain in Washington? And that's what's happening, because we've got unelected bureaucrats passing down rules, regulations, and mandates as if it's law.
And people at the state level don't stand up and backstop.
Yeah, and we believe that the 10th Amendment says, shame on you, Washington, you don't have that authority. That's our responsibility.
Okay. And shame on us for not exercising our authority.
So what's our hope?
So first of all, I'd venture to say there's a lot of elected officials that would never, ever meet with the Tea Party group in general. But I still do on a regular basis and take the barbs about non-lawyers or whatever, because, you know.
But we try to be respectful.
You know, the statements I'm saying are legal. They aren't what
personal opinion.
What you like or what you don't like. It's what the Supreme Court and the law say. Secondly, elections matter. You know, we can't cover that more. You know, how many congressmen did that you have that every time the president says jump, they say how high? Elections matter. You know, it's time for the American public to wake up. It makes a difference. The Supreme Court is decided in large part by the president. He makes the nominations. Look at the ages of the justices. Look at the ages. They aren't spring chickens. So for any of you that may tell me next September, you know, I really wanted blank, but the Republican nominee is Y. I don't want to hear it. Because the question simply, do you want Hillary to choose the next justices, which there will be several of, or do you want someone else choosing the next justices? It's that simple.
The new justices are spring chickens, the three ones.
Yes, absolutely. So, I mean, by definition, you can have cynicism, you can have frustration, I get it. But the only thing that solves that is by changing Washington, by having people that understand the limited role the federal government's supposed to have. And that doesn't happen, frankly, by having a cup of coffee here and complaining to the Attorney General. It really takes your butts kicking tail at November elections. I mean, it's that simple.
Do we have one question from somebody who hasn't asked one yet? Somebody has something they might want to ask?
So, I mean, in theory, I'm happy, frankly, I think the discussion's really healthy. Gets you thinking, gets you, etc. I think it's all very, very positive. Even if you disagree with me, it's very, very positive. But if come November, you haven't spent the prior X number of months trying to make a difference on national elections, then the only thing you've done is given yourself a lot of gastric upset. So, I mean, you gotta get off your rear ends. That's the way you deal with the process.
David, there was one back here.
Yes?
I had a question about this same-sex marriage case.
Right.
Now, I recollect, it's been a long time since I've taken common law. But my recollection is the Warren Court actually incorporated a lot of Bill of Rights that were applicable only to the federal government, to the state government.
True.
A series of opinions. And I haven't looked at it as it pertains to the same-sex marriage case. But the point is, it was only the federal government prior to those decisions to which the Fifth Amendment and Fourth Amendment, some of the others actually applied to.
True.
If you went back and stripped out that decision and were dealing only with the original language of the Constitution, absent that opinion, where are you vis-a-vis this issue?
So let me answer the question two ways differently.
Sure.
Number one, when the decision came out 2 years ago on DOMA, the author of the opinion talked about due process and equal protection. And Justice Scalia, in a very vigorous dissent, said that portends a real big problem because that language should not have been in the opinion, the Windsor case. So that's one answer. Justice Scalia saw the problem, covered it 2 years ago. Nothing gray about his position. I happen to think he's a great justice. Number two, the way in which you potentially deal with what you just covered with me is the election of presidents and those members that are part of the Supreme Court. You can only go forward, you can't go backwards, and you go forward based on who are the justices of the court. There is no question that if a Ruth Bader Ginsburg resigned 3 years from now, notice I'm saying resign, I'm not wishing any. You know. There's no question that if Hillary Clinton is president, you're going to get one type of justice. And if another person is president, you're going to get another type of justice. The elections matter. You can complain, you can be frustrated, you can get all upset. The truth of the matter is November means a lot. And when you're talking to me correctly, that there are a lot of 5-4 decisions, that election will alter a lot. Who's the 5 and who's the 4? So you can either be very constructive with the electoral process, or you can have hot air. I'm not interested in hot air. I'm interested in results. Results are based on November of 16. That's put as simply as I can put it. Pleasure to be with you all today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. A couple of things. If we've got some new signs up here. Tea Party Patriot Alliance meets Monday, 7 p.m. Central Park, and the address.
Can I talk about that?
The signs?
Yeah, I'm the one.
Sure. Okay.
I just would ask you guys a really big favor. This was the original, and of course it's going away, unless you put it out where you think it's going to get stolen. That's what these would be for. This, we had all these extras, and so I just hated to throw it away, so we took out the Patriot Alliance, and these are the new ones. I have six more coming. We have six, five, and these are sprinkled around. For people that live maybe 5 miles or further away from here, if you would take a sign and put it near a stoplight, or you know, a red light or a stop sign, where when people stop, they can look at it. Just one or two per person would you know, increase a lot more of our exposure. Because all these signs are, you know, around here. And so if somebody is around Doc Randlett Road and 9 or 20 or north of here or south of here, it would certainly increase our exposure. It would do a lot, as much as the emails.
Yes.
And much appreciated. So take one or two home, if you would. The only caveat on this is Tuesday, you got to pick it up. Because if you leave it out, it gets ignored or gets destroyed. But if you can put these out on like Friday night, you know, where people can see it over the weekend, and then pick it up on Tuesday, it'd be wonderful. We really need that. I can't do it myself.
Yeah. I think they do more than emails, because we can't reach the people that these reach. Some basic sign rules really quickly for you guys. Those of us who put out thousands of signs. Ideally, you want to have permission of the landowner. There's places that are considered public spaces, and you can put a sign on there, but the city or county will sometimes pick them up. The general rule, they can't be in the city or county right of way. So the broad stroke rule is, if you put a sign out, try to put it behind the telephone pole. So you'll see telephone poles on the side of the road. If you go behind the telephone poles, you're out of the city right of way. Swanee is very aggressive at picking up signs. If they see a sign, they'll pick it up. There are people who are not a fan of the Tea Party, and unlike us, who would leave their signs, they will take ours. I put signs out for the city for Swanee meetings. I go out there, put the signs out, and park in my car there for a couple hours, and then take the signs and leave so that they stay there. Because they're expensive. I don't have anything to do anyway, so that's easy. So I've been asked a couple of things. Another thing is, if you have a badge that's a fancy one, I guess not like mine, but you've got one that's got the name, if you could remember to drop that off on your way out the door. Do we have, yes, and we have some free material.
Hello, my name is Nydia Tisdale. I have copies of the Red Book for everyone to take home with you. It's the Georgia Sunshine Laws, A Citizen's Guide to Open Government. They're put out by the Attorney General's Office, and the First Amendment Foundation, and the Georgia Press Association. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. So they're up here. If you want to come get one. Steve Ramey, yes?
Do you want to talk about, as we talked about in the last meeting, about the Republican Party being our vehicle in order to make change?
The Republican Party is our vehicle in order to make change. We have two parties essentially in Georgia. We've been encouraging for years people to get involved with their local party. Here in Forsyth, we have a pretty good county party. There's a 7th district party that also covers this. And then state party is less important. There is a state convention coming up. How many people will be going to the state convention as a delegate? Look at that. That's excellent. That's outstanding. Because that's how you can change the party. There's actually, so we encourage you to get involved in that. We do have a meeting on Thursday, actually in Lawrenceville. The one in Lawrenceville is going to be an excellent presentation. Mike Scoopin right there did it the other day. I'm excited about hearing it again. It has to do with, I use the word nullification. It's a long story. You kind of have to hear the whole story. I discovered, by the way, real quick, when I was getting ready for the Attorney General, I went back and did some research. In 2009, I did not know this. Senate passed a resolution, Senate Resolution 632. April 1st, 2009, I'm just going to read you a little blurb I found about it. And let me know if you ever heard of this. Georgia State Senate passed Resolution 43-1 that asserted the right of the states to nullify federal laws under some circumstances. The resolution also asserted that if Congress, the President, or the federal judiciary took certain steps, such as establishing martial law without state consent, requiring some types of involuntary servitude, taking any action regarding religion or restraining freedom of political speech, or establishing further prohibitions on types or quantities of firearms or ammunition, the Constitution establishing the United States government would be considered nullified and the Union would be dissolved. I never heard that. So I'm going to do some research on that. Senate Resolution 632, it passed unanimously, overwhelmingly in the Senate, I guess it never made it to the House. 2009, April 1st, 2009. So, had you heard of this?
What does our Attorney General think of that?
He's done.
Resolutions are resolutions.
That's right. Yeah.
Especially when it's one body.
Yes, and so it didn't go anywhere. So I just thought that was interesting. I'll do some research on that. Anybody else have any important housekeeping announcements? We could use help with the chairs if you can.
Always, we need help with the chairs. We get the whole white together, gray together.
We thank you so much for coming out. I don't know how long the Attorney General will stay around. I'll be around for another 20, 30 minutes. You can come talk to me. I'm sure Hank will be around. Other people also. Thank you again for coming. Hope to see you next month.
Thank you very much.
I don't, I'm in the process of making some money, but we're going to do it on Facebook, and also show my content. Well, actually, is there enough I can take like three of these?
Help yourself, okay. Take as many as you like.
Thank you so much for coming. I wish I got to talk to you more. Like a very charming person.